Thank you, Madhvi. Our speaker for today, Dr. Akhtar Parvez, is a university librarian at the Maulana Azad Urdu University and is a nodal officer for all the department and 12 satellite campus libraries of the university. Prior to joining the Maulana Azad National Urdu University in January 2017, he worked as a librarian at the prestigious Indian Institute of Management, Indore. He was also the first appellate authority on RTI matters at IIM Indore. Dr. Parvez has about 32 years of professional experience of working in prestigious institutions, both in government and private sector. These institutions include the National Council of Applied and Economic Research, the American Center, USIS, New Delhi, DelNet, India International Center, the ICRA, and IIM Indore. Dr. Parvez has authored and edited 10 books, has contributed 20 papers in journals and books, and has delivered more than 200 invited lectures on the various issues related to the field of library and information services. Dr. Parvez specializes in designing processes in various operational areas of library management and has successfully implemented them in his libraries, leading to staff efficiency enhancement. He is the managing editor of the Journal of Library Management and is on the editorial board of the International Journal, E-Journal of Library Science and International Research Journal of Library and Information Science, published by the King Saud University, Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. Dr. Parvez was recognized as the outstanding management librarian by the Association of the Indian Management Scholars and Institute of Rural Management, Anand, PIRMA, Promising Professional Award by SRFLIS, Best Young Librarian Award from Indore Division Library Association, Vishwa Lakshmi Best Management Librarian Award, and few other prestigious awards in the field of library and information services. Dr. Parvez is the founder member of Management Libraries Network, ManLibNet, and has been contributing to ManLibNet activities since 1998-99. In addition to holding the position of the General Secretary, ManLibNet, he was also the treasurer of the Indian Library Association from 2002 to 2004, and then again from 2004 to 2007. We are privileged to have sir with us for this session on copyright. Now I request sir to take over the session and guide our participants. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, madam. And I would like to express my sincere gratitude to both the institution and in particular the Honorable Vice Chancellor and the Principal, Professor Kanwar. And I would also like to thank both the librarians, Dr. Meghna and Dr. Madhvi, for giving me this opportunity to speak on this topic today. And I'm very happy that, you see, I'm today joined by Dr. Shriram Pandey also from BHU. And it'll be great to, listen to Dr. Pandey. So let me just put this disclaimer at the beginning of my talk that I'm not a legal expert in copyright. But, you know, I know copyright to the extent what is necessary to carry out my job as a librarian. So with this disclaimer, let me just share my screen with you. And let me also mention here that I was very impressed to see the professionalism by both the institution. Because first, when they were speaking to me about this webinar, they sent me a concept note, which generally doesn't happen in our webinars. And just a few days back, I got an email asking my permission whether they can host my YouTube recording on the internet. So I felt, you know, okay, I am also, I can also hold the copyright on few things. Generally, see, this was probably the first time that somebody asked me for my permission to put my video on the internet. So thank you very much for that. I really appreciate that. So with this, let me just share my screen with you. Hope you are able to see my screen. Okay. So, you know, though my topic today is copyright concern and challenges for online education, let me tell you that, you know, online education is a small part of today's discussion. But what is important is to understand the copyright and the issues involved in it, which may be, you know, fair use, etc. And I'll be talking more on fair use because this is the area I feel that generally, you know, we do not have an idea what is fair use and what is not fair use. So this is the picture of my university, which you see on your screen. And this is a brief of our university. And the important thing about our university is that it provides education right from primary school to, you know, up to PhD level. So this is one of the very important salient features of our university. So let us begin the presentation today. You know, what is intellectual property? Basically, it is creation of mind, you know, like inventions, literary and artistic work, like, you know, we come out with novel, fiction, journal articles, then designs and symbols, names and images used in commerce. And this is the definition which was given by World Intellectual Property Organization. And the ambit is quite wide. You know, a lot of things can come under intellectual property, which, you know, we sometimes may not even recognize or imagine. So for example, you know, today I am giving this presentation, this is called performance. So this is also, or this can also be copyrighted. And like physical property, you know, this is also protected by a law called copyright law. I mean, for obviously copyright related issues. And the intellectual property can be in the form of patents, copyright, trademarks, trade secrets, geographical indicators, etc. You know, fortunately or unfortunately, this is a state-created monopoly. So when I say state-created monopoly, I mean that, you know, though somebody has come out with an invention or somebody has come out with some other creative work, and the copyright is with that person only or with that institution only. Others, you know, do not have the right on that. But at the same time, you know, it is important that such intellect is protected by some kind of law, which is, of course, different laws which come in under IPR. And I feel it is a, you know, balance between the interest of the person who has created some work and, of course, the general good of the public. You know, it is so important that in the UN Universal Declaration of Human Rights, it was considered as one of the human rights, but not human right per se. So in Article 27, it is written that everyone has the right to the protection of the moral and material interests resulting from any scientific, literary, or artistic production of which he is the author. So you can, you know, understand the importance of this. So I'll briefly talk about patent and other things, and then you see our discussion will focus on copyright only. So patent is an exclusive right granted for an invention, which you all know, and which is generally for 20 years in India. And trademark, you all know about trademark. We all see trademarks, you see, when we go to market. These are some of the images which you are very familiar with. So these are the trademarks that people get registered in their name so that their product is recognized by their trademark. And trade secret is something, you know, if there is a product, you know, for which there's a formula for preparation, so those things come under trade secrets. And such information is valuable information, commercially, and it comes under secrecy protection, and it provides competitive advantage over others. So that is trade secrets. And of course, then geographical indicators, like, you know, we have Assam tea, Darjeeling tea, etc. Now the question is, you know, why there are intellectual property laws, and if these laws were not there, then what would have had happened? You know, we come out or we publish books. Okay, why we publish books? Because we want recognition, number one, and we also want some kind of revenue from such publications. And similarly, you know, you all know about Google. Google came out with such a fantastic search engine. If IPR laws were not there, we are not sure whether Google would have really come out with such a system. Google probably would not have come out with or invented a driverless car, which has already been tested in one of the cities in America. People would not have come out with so many apps that we see almost on a daily basis. So, you know, these things actually provide, these inventions or these works provide support to the economy also. A large number of people get employment through these works. And having said that, there is a lot of piracy also. So, you know, when there is piracy, you know, it impacts our economy and a lot of people lose their jobs. So that is one important aspect why IPR laws are required. And these are some of the IPR laws, you know, right from copyright to others. So, as I said, we will focus on Copyright Act 1957 and, of course, amendments thereon, which is important for academicians and librarians, of course. So, copyright basically, you know, this law grants authors, artists, performers, producers of music and other creators protection for their works. And this is what Section 14 of the Indian Copyright Act says. So basically, you know, it grants authors a lot of things to do, and those things are protected. And as I said, it is a state-created monopoly, but this monopoly actually has been created to incentivize the creators. But, you know, as I said a few minutes back also, that this is a balance between the interest of the creators and general public good. And that is the reason why the monopoly, which is created by a state, is for a limited period. So what is that limited period? That also we'll be discussing. Generally, you know, if you talk of creative works, it is lifetime of the author and, of course, a particular number of years. So anyone who contributes a protectable expression is protected under the law. And these are some of the images by which you will get an idea as to what all can be protected, right? From, you know, fiction, poetry, compilation, then we have softwares, films, paintings, plays, choreography, photos, sculptures, design. So a lot of things, you know, come under this these laws. So just briefly to discuss about the history of copyright in the United Kingdom. You know, in the middle of the 15th century, the idea of copyright emerged with the issuance of letters, patents by the King of England. And where, you know, it was also suggested that an author or the creator of the work will give a copy to a particular printer, and that printer will have exclusive right on printing. So there are two kinds of rights. One is exclusive right, which an author can give, and another is non-exclusive right. So exclusive right is, you know, when I give a right only to one person to do a particular job. For example, distribution of my books. I give only to one person. That is exclusive. So now what is non-exclusive? Say, for example, there is a database which we purchase or we subscribe to in our libraries. So that database is actually just not given to you, but to a large number of people. So those are non-exclusive licenses, you can say. So as I said, the author or the creator of the work used to give a copy to a particular printer who used to print. And that is why it is called copyright. And then there was a company of the government called the Royal Company of Stationers, which was given the right to publish. The good thing was that this company was supposed to deposit a copy of every book with the Oxford University Library. And this arrangement was done after an agreement was signed between Thomas Bodley in 1610, who was the librarian of the Oxford University. And still, you know, if you go to the University of Oxford, you will find that the libraries carry his name, which is called Bodleian Libraries, University of Oxford. So in India, you know, the first time when copyright came, it was 1847 during British East India Company. And then it was 1914 under British Raj. And then finally, you know, we had one act in 1957. And this act saw a lot of amendments, almost six amendments, right from 1983 to 2012. And these amendments were basically to accommodate newer things which are coming. Like, for example, you know, how do we use digital content? So it was, these amendments were generally to accommodate something or the other. Now, a lot of people, you know, question whether registering a copyright mandatory or adding the symbol C essential for protection under the Copyright Act. You know, as I earlier said, anything, you know, which is in the protectable expression automatically comes under copyright. So whether you put this C or do not put this C, it is copyrighted. But you know, it is advisable that, you know, whenever you are publishing something or creating something, if you put this C, it will be good, because putting this C gives an impression to the other person that who is the copyright holder. And this C you do not actually need to register. So just putting simple C within circle is sufficient. You know, as I said, it's not required to be registered, but if you register, it will be good. So whether you register or not, your rights will be covered under this copyright. And, you know, copyright stands for the legal rights exclusively. See, again, you see, you should understand this meaning of exclusively. Given to the authors or creators of intellectual work. So copyright protects works of authorship in any tangible medium of expression, like writing, music, art, computer software, film, etc. But you know, here the originality is important. You see, you cannot go and get work registered which is not original. Just a second, let me just put my earplugs, because some noise is coming. Just a second, please.
Yeah, so the copyright works in India enjoy same rights and privileges in other countries which are members of the Berne Convention, which India joined in 1928 and US joined in 1988. You know, this Berne Convention actually provides you protection internationally. You see, you don't need to have your work registered in US or some other country if you want protection internationally. So if you have this C within circle, then it will be protected internationally. And all the C or copyrighted works which are produced in other countries are protected in India. So, you know, these are some of the important agreements or conventions which happened in the past. And the most important for us is the Berne Convention, which happened in 1886, Switzerland. It was mainly for authors. And here, let me tell you that when US joined this convention in 1988, earlier they were having 50 years after the death of the author, the copyright protection. But when they joined, they made it 70 years. So these are some of the important convention. And I would suggest that whenever you get time, you please read about these. So let us talk about copyright duration. So what is copyright duration?
It subsists for a definite period of time. Of course, throughout the lifetime of the author and a particular number of years. So if you see the duration, it varies from country to country. So for example, in India, it is lifetime of the author plus 60 years, and they are calendar years, which means an author dies in 2020, the calendar year calculation will start counting from 1st January 2021. And in US, it is lifetime of the author plus 70 years. And if there are multiple authors of a particular work, then when the last person when he dies, this copyright duration will start counting from that particular year. And these are actually some of the duration, how it actually traveled from 1790, it was earlier 14 years, and renewable up to 14 years, so 28 years, then it went to 48, 42 years, etc., etc. So now we see that copyright sometimes exists for over 100 years, and the reason is that the life expectancy is going up. So let us now talk of the ownership, who owns the copyright. So there is always issues as to who owns the copyright, whether it is author, employer, publisher, the government, or the librarian. I'm saying librarian because it comes under fair use, a lot of copyrighted material. Author says that I am the creator of the work, hence I should have the copyright. Publisher says that you have transferred the copyright to me, so I hold the copyright. But employer says that you have produced this work during the course of your employment in the organization, hence the organization will have the copyright. And the government says this work, it was done for the government, hence the copyright is with the government. And librarians say, okay, you may have this copyright, but I have the right to make fair use for my users. So let us briefly understand who owns the copyright. So, for work in the course of employment under a contract, employer is the owner, unless there is a contract saying otherwise. But when it comes to books, journals, etc., they are treated individual rights normally, as I said, unless there is a contract which says just the opposite. Treatment for sponsored research can be different. The copyright holder may be your institution, the government, or it may be you. Depends on the kind of license or agreement that you have with the funding agency. So for example, if there are two authors, okay, somebody was asking me yesterday, so if there are two authors and one has made a video and the other has given us a music of, say, 1 minute in the video. So, but just by giving just 1 minute or 30 seconds video, the other person, it becomes the copyright holder. Okay, so if you have any proceeds, if you get any revenue from that video, then person who has just given a music for 30 seconds, he will also be entitled for those things. So therefore, it is important, when we take help of some other people for preparing our creative work, it is good to have a agreement. And this right-hand side, document that you see, that as a member of one of the committees, I prepared this document along with other members of the committee. So can we say that we have copyright on this document? We cannot say, because this document has been prepared in the course of my employment, which does not come under as journal or journal article, book chapter, books, etc. So what are the creator's rights? Let us understand briefly. Of course, to reproduce the copyright work. So for example, if you have a book, you can reproduce it in any form. You have the right to distribute copies of works in public to public. You will have the right to produce or prepare derivative works. So what are derivative works? When, say, for example, a novel is converted into a movie, or a performance is recorded and then put it on the YouTube. So those things are derivative works. To perform the copyrighted works, which can be dance, music, performance, etc. For example, the performance today that I am giving to you, that is also copyrighted. To display the copyrighted works, grant permissions. So as I said, you see, you can grant permissions exclusively or non-exclusively, which means that you can grant permission to a particular person or you can grant permission to multiple people for using your work. And in databases, in journals databases, what we see that is, as I said, non-exclusive rights. And similarly, if you have, say, for example, given a right to someone, some publisher for printing your book, so that publisher cannot just make that book in electronic form. So he will again have to take your permission for that. So, and copyright, is applicable to both, whether your document is published or unpublished. Okay, so that you have to remember. So let us now understand what is the difference between copyright infringement and plagiarism. A lot of people get confused with these two. So copyright infringement is using someone else's work without obtaining their permission. Okay, and plagiarism means that someone claims attribution for a work which he or she did not create or author, okay, or using someone else's work without acknowledging or crediting the source. So that is the basic difference between copyright and plagiarism. So if you see the copyright, affected party generally lodges the complaint, but in case of plagiarism, anybody can go to the higher institution and say that, you see, someone has plagiarized. Now, copyright infringement cases are taken up by court of law, whereas plagiarism cases are handled by Departmental Academic Integrity Panel or by Institutional Academic Integrity Panel or any other such body, which is, in case of central government, it will have to follow the UGC regulation of 2018. Then copyright comes under criminal law system, and the person infringing the copyright can be convicted or for compensation or imprisonment. And in case of plagiarism, in extreme cases of reputed plagiarism, the higher education institution does have the right to terminate that particular person. But that has to be, as I said, extreme cases of plagiarism, which means the plagiarism which falls under level 3 of the UGC regulation, and that too repeated plagiarism. So talking of the digital content which we use our online classes or otherwise, so this digital content comes with lot of restriction, and you have to be very, very careful when you use digital content in the class, online class, or when you put something on YouTube, the recording. So, how do I decide about using any copyrighted material? I think that is important that we should first understand, because if we have this understanding, probably we will have complete understanding of the fact that what can be used and what cannot be used. So there could be something in public domain. So anything in on the public domain can be used, but that public domain does not mean that anything on the internet, because in the internet there can be a lot of things which come with copyright licensing. Then there are exceptions, like classroom exceptions, exceptions for especially abled people, exception for libraries. So that we have to understand. Then there are licensing issues, and then permission issues, and then fair use. So let us have a detailed understanding of each of these, so that we are able to make a call about using a copyrighted material. So when we discuss public domain, you know, public domain refers to creative works that are not protected under copyright and any other form of IPR laws. So only such work can be called as works which are there in the public domain. And the work falls under the public domain if the copyright term has expired, number one, which means, say, the lifetime of the author and 60 years in India. Second is copyright owner puts his or her work in the public domain. And, you know, once you put your work in the public domain as a freely used material, you cannot just revoke it. See, it has to be always there. You cannot change the license. Then the work which cannot be copyrighted, for example, titles of books, facts, ideas, slogans, or short phrases. Now, when I say facts, say, for example, you know, I write a research paper and there are some numbers, okay, which are there for anybody to use. So those numbers, etc., are not copyrighted. But yes, if I use the same way the original author has interpreted those numbers, not interpreted, but presented those numbers, then it will be copyright infringement. You know, every now and then, you know, we take images from Google, but we don't realize that these images also have copyright. So the best practice would be to first go to tools, and then, you know, if you go to tools, then these rights will appear, so you can choose any of those rights. So whether it is labeled for example, this one, this is labeled for reuse, and this is labeled for non-commercial reuse. So these are different types of usage rights. So you can select one of the appropriate right for your work. Now, similarly, you know, on Flickr, you see some of the very beautiful images. And here again, you know, you can use all the images which come under Creative Commons licenses, but those Creative Commons licenses you have to see. I'm sure Dr. Sriram will speak about those CC licenses in detail, so I'll not go into the details. So secondly, you know, if you want to use a video, or if you want to adapt a video, or if you want to remix a video and make a video of your own, a new video. So the best thing is whenever you search, for example, I search library stock verification here, and this is the video which I had prepared on stock verification. And this is the button for, you know, filter. So if I go to filter, and if I choose Creative Commons licenses videos, then only those videos will come, not the other videos. So you can then, you know, see the licenses and accordingly use that. Now, similarly, see, if you want to use some of the legal, some of the music in your videos, so you can again go to Creative Commons website. And these are some of the licenses. I'm sure this will be explained by Dr. Sriram. So I'm not going into the details. And you can go on this website to know more about these Creative Commons licenses. Now, the other thing, you know, after this public domain, let us understand what are exceptions for a classroom. So face-to-face classroom has a lot of exceptions, okay? So whatever you do in the classroom for education purposes, that will come under exceptions under the copyright law. But, you know, there are some conditions. The conditions are that it should be a not-for-profit organization. It should the copy or the work which you are using in your classroom should have been lawfully obtained or made. The students must be sensitized that the material used in the classroom is subject to the copyright, and they must refrain from distributing. You know, there is a very thin line between using it for a class and for distribution purpose. So, for example, you know, I'll give you an example of you know, what we see these days on WhatsApp groups. I saw that someone sent the PDF of the whole magazine, And then the argument was because that website says that you can share the story, so that is why we are putting it in the public domain or distributing it in different WhatsApp group. You know, it is not the case. Sharing a particular story is completely different from sharing the whole document. That we have to understand. So we should be very, very careful when we, you know, forward messages or such PDFs. Similarly, you know, I see on various library science email groups that they send a request for email, and then, you know, a lot of other people who respond, they send that document marking to everyone. So that is, again, see, distribution, and that is not the right thing. You may be infringing the copyright of someone. Then, you know, as I said, yeah, if you want to put the recording, if you do record the classroom performance, etc., can you put it on the internet? You cannot put, okay, because that will become distribution. Okay, so you have to see whether I have right for distribution or not. Then, you know, if it is online class, you'll have to make sure that it is a closed registered group of students who are enrolled in your institution. And at the same time, you know, institution's responsibility is to create necessary mechanisms so that the interest of the creators are protected, or there are security measures. So if necessary, you know, institutions can have a policy in place which can be given to faculty members, so that, and of course, students who should comply with all the necessary copyright norms. So the one very an important thing which you have to see is the amount of material which you used in a face-to-face classroom or a physical classroom. It has to be completely different in an online classroom. Say, for example, you use an article, okay, in the class, the whole article you can use, there is no problem. But when you use in an online class, you cannot really use that whole article which your institution might be subscribing. So the best thing would be to give a link so that, you know, you don't have that copyright infringement problems. Or else, you know, you can just see the licenses. Maybe you can talk to your librarian and see what the license say. And, you know, see, whenever you are using any material from other places, make sure that you credit that, okay? And the students, again, must be sensitized about the copyright issues. And neither the students nor, you see, the other people in the institutions should interfere in the, you know, in the mechanism which has been made by the publisher or the creator to protect that particular work. So what you can do in online classes, you know, you can try, you know, locking the PDFs, or, you know, you can adopt streaming, which should not be downloadable. You can disable right click in all your, you know, presentations, whatever you do with the students in the online mode. And you know, use low resolution pictures, etc. So these are the some of the things which you can do. But, you know, no system is perfect. Even see, these things can be, you know, tempered by people who are very intelligent. So, but, you know, you should make a reasonable effort to ensure that you are not infringing the rights of the copyright holder. So as I earlier also said, you know, the subscribe databases have a lot of restrictions, e-content. So you should probably perhaps contact the librarian to read the license agreements, or you can check with her. Then, you know, there are exceptions for library. So public libraries, it is given in the Copyright Act that only public libraries can make copies, or this exception will apply to only public library. So what does public library mean? It does not mean what, you know, we are generally understand in librarianship. So public library, in my opinion, means that any not-for-profit libraries, and as it is written there also, that it should not be a corporate library. So in library, you can make 3 copies of any particular book, provided that is damaged or the copy is not available in the market at a fair price. In 2012 amendment of the Copyright Act, we see that it permits us for storing every library document, okay? But here, let me tell you, the permission is only for storing. You should not consider this permission for distribution. So the distribution can be to the extent of your library premises. So for example, if you have stored your documents, so you can make those documents accessible to people within your library, within the four walls of the library. Why? Because the Copyright Act, the amendment does not permit you for distribution. But when I say the storing, I'm not taking it in a very narrow perspective. Say storing also means that we can have fair use of that document and using within the premises of that digital document, in my opinion, is fair use. So purpose of, as I said, purpose should be preservation, not distribution. And in case you are providing photocopy services in the library, make sure it is cost to cash cost. It should not become a business for your library that you are earning revenue from that. Otherwise, it will not fall. This exception will not apply to you. And to the extent possible, libraries should notify this everywhere in the library that one has to apply. One has to, make sure that he or she complies with the copyright norms. And there are exceptions for specially abled person. For example, the book can be converted into, the text can be converted into audio, and that audio can be given to the specially abled person. But this exception perhaps will not apply to normal students. I'm not saying the others are abnormal. But what I'm saying, that generally it will not apply to those students who are not especially abled people. Then, comes the licensing thing. So licensing, as I said, is a permission to use intellectual property. Okay. So you don't have the right, but you have permission to use. And digital content comes with a lot of severe restriction compared to the print material. Like for example, print copy, you can very well sell in the market, secondhand copy, but ebook, perhaps you cannot sell. And the licensing is such that you can use some material only on your IP, or it will be user ID or password based. Remote access may or may not be allowed to you by the publisher. There may be some download restrictions. There interlibrary loan, you may be allowed, you may not be allowed. If you're allowed, there has to be a particular mechanism in which you're allowed. It should not happen that we should freely send PDFs to other libraries. Then you have to see the definition of authorized users or an authorized sites. Like for example, who are the authorized, whether the students, faculty, or the authorized students also means that whoever visit or the visitor to the library or to your institution. So then there are things like DRM protection, no DRM or DRM free, which means if you have a DRM protected ebook, then you can use on a particular device. You may have difficulties in using it on other devices. Whereas no DRM books are better to be procured because it can be used everywhere. And then you also have to, librarians mainly have to see whether there is any updation fee or any platform fee or any annual fee, etc., of the product that you subscribe, that you purchase. Then whether these digital, in digital content, whether you are allowed to make course packs of that. What happens if titles get discontinued? Do they become part of CLOCKS, which is a non-profit organization or society, which actually archives all the documents or the titles which are discontinued by publishers? You have to be very, very careful. You have to read the fine prints in the licensing agreement whenever you are using, or whenever you are rather purchasing or subscribing to a document. So this was all about licensing. Then comes the permissions. So how do we obtain permissions? Of course, you will first have to identify who owns the permission. And then how do you identify it? Generally, it is a C within circle is written. So, but sometimes if you call a publisher, he may say, no, I don't have the copyright. It is with the author. And then, you know, it's better whenever you are getting any, whenever you want to get any permission, send a formal request, and you can send an email, because email is a evidence which can be proved in the court of law under Information Technology Act of 2000. So it is better to keep things on record, like, you know, your institution declaration from me that I have no issue in putting my YouTube video on the internet. So, but whenever you're asking for any permissions, make sure that you have complete clarity on the scope, what you want, whether you want for print copies permission, or which the image which you want to use, and the image if you want to use, whether that image has to be used within the book or as a cover, because, you know, the charges of image which is which may be produced on a cover may be different from, you see, when it is put in the book. And sometimes, you know, copyright holder is not identifiable or traceable, but, you know, you should make your reasonable effort in locating the person who has the copyright. So now let us understand what is a fair use. So fair use, see, all the time we make fair use without realizing that we are making fair use. We take a lot of material from other articles, we use it, we give citation, references. So that is fair use, that is no problem. Now, so fair use basically is a doctrine which allows a person to make limited use of copyrighted work without the permission of the owner. And this includes, as I said, you know, reproduction in the course of fair dealing, like, for example, for research, teaching, etc., reproduction for educational purposes. Libraries make a lot of copies of articles, so that is also permissible, provided that is within a particular range. And then, you know, there is an organization called Indian Reprographic Rights Organization, which says if you take our membership, we will provide, I mean, you can make 50% of the photocopy of a book. But, you know, I really don't understand why this membership needs to be taken, because even without taking this membership, you know, you have the right of making, of using a document under fair use exception. And then, you see, unfortunately, this protection of copyright is almost standardized in all the countries, but after Bern Convention, of course, but when it comes to fair use, so, you know, interpretation is different. So, unfortunately, there's no such mechanism by which we can understand, okay, this is fair to use and that is not fair use. So now we have, I hope we have understood these five things very clearly about public domain, exceptions, licensing, permissions, fair use. Now I come back to the same questions. How do I decide about using any copyrighted material? So look at these things very carefully. See, check whether the material which you want to use is copyrighted or not. So if it is in public domain, there is no problem. You can use it. If it is copyright material, then explore if there is any exception allowed in the Copyright Act. And if you know, there is no exception, just check what is the licensing says about the work to be used. And if you fail to, you know, get a proper answer, maybe, see, you can explore if you can use or make use of fair use. And if you fail in that also, you will have to check, you see, whether you need to get permission from the copyright holder or not. So, for example, I said, you know, sometimes it is not possible to identify who is the copyright holder. So it is, again, you know, it's better to, again, explore the possibility whether, you see, your use is fair use. So I'll take, I think, 5 more minutes to finish my presentation. So I got a very useful document on the Columbia website, which is basically a checklist of copyrighted material, which is divided into 4 categories. That is purpose and nature of material used. Okay, the third is amount of use, and the fourth is effect of use. And this checklist is available on the URL which is mentioned above, and this is under CC license, that is Creative Commons. So I said that this is a very good document which I found. So you can evaluate the purpose, okay? Whether your purpose, there are two columns. One is favoring fair use, other is opposing fair use. So if you fall under this category, that is teaching, research, scholarship, with regard to, of course, the purpose, criticism, comment, news reporting, transformative or productive use. So what is transformative use? Transformative use is like, I'll give you an example. On one of the TV news channel, I think Aaj Tak or something, there's a song or parody comes with the name So Sorry. So they take some other songs and make a transformative use. So that is called transformative use. I think this will fall under parody. This is not transformative use. Transformative use, something which is not a substitute for your work. Okay. And then you can see whether, you know, your purpose is restrictive access only for your students, etc. And then the parody, which I just explained about Aaj Tak. And if you fall under this category, then probably the purpose will not fall under the fair use. Then the other is nature of material being used. So if it is published material, it is easier, but if it is unpublished material, it is little difficult. So if it is factual or non-fiction based, there is, generally no problem. But if it is highly creative work like music, novels, etc., or plays, films, then there's a problem. Because here the rights, the copyright may be a little restrictive. So does it actually favor educational objectives? So those things you'll have to, evaluate. Then the amount of use. So what does favor you? Is it a small use? No problem. But if it is large, there's a problem. Then a portion used is, and despite the fact that you may be using a small quantity, but there is maybe a possibility that it may be a central or significant portion of that work. So if it is significant portion of that, then perhaps that use may not be fair use, if it is heart of the work, sorry. So amount is appropriate for favored educational. So if that's the case, then it's fine. So it should not be the heart of the entire work, though it may be small. And then this last table of effect of use. Effect, when I say, is it really affecting the market of the person, your fair use? Say, if you are making one copy or two copies, it's fine, but are you making 100 copies? So that's the problem, or more than so, 3 copies, then there's a problem. So that you have to see. So maybe, if you get a chance to see this fair use checklist on the website of Columbia University, please do that. It will help you. And once you are able to answer these questions, I'm very sure you will be able to make a fair understanding what is to be used and what is not to be used. Now, copyright, the definition of fair use has completely been changed after the Delhi University court case between Oxford University Press and Rameshwari Photocopy and University of Delhi, where the judge or the justice Endlow ignored even the quantity, because I just said that the amount is one, the amount of use should be less, but here in this case that was ignored by the court, and there was a very important editorial which was published in the Indian Express, which I will tell you. So here, the publisher was not happy with the court judgment, and then when they went to the Supreme Court in March 2017, but then again they withdrew the their court because they thought they should not unnecessarily fight with their own stakeholders. So this Indian Express editorial came, and it was very critical of the judgment. And it says that ruling in DU copyright case reflects the inability of Indian courts to integrate legal outcomes with the robust business models. So this was very critical, and I would suggest that you please read it. So, about this judgment, as I said, it ignored the quantity. And by this judgment, one can always say that now there's a judgment, I can use the judgment to photocopy everything that I want. And but does this judgment passed in Delhi High Court is applicable to other state? Because Supreme Court is the law of the land, yeah, it does apply because, you see, it has not been nullified by any of the other state in the country. And nobody, you see, went to oppose this judgment in other states. So as of today, it is valid. But as a librarian or, you know, as a creative work, my opinion on this would be that academic institutions should interpret the judgment in the right spirit and should not consider the court judgment as a license to violate the prevalent copyright and IPR norms. And being in the same fraternity, you know, we must respect the IPR of its creators. Now, you know, this is a very good example of transformative copyright material. And this, there was a court case between HathiTrust and the Authors Guild in US. And there, you see, what basically these people do, they digitize a lot of material, put on HathiTrust website, and make it accessible to the general public. And in most of the cases, you know, it is just the metadata which is available to people, or it is there are books which are free of copyright, they are put there. So there was a court case, and the court ruled, this is again, I think, High Court, it is yet to be decided in the Supreme Court. See, the court said that because the creation of a full text searchable database was transformative use, the copying was not excessive, and the full text search function did not serve as a substitute for the books that were being searched. So it allowed the HathiTrust of doing what they were doing. So this was a very interesting case. We have to see what the Supreme Court says. So just last slide, that you know, we should have very clear understanding of fair use. We should always read the fine prints in the licensing agreement, and we should keep all the document related to seeking of permissions safe. Why? Because copyright lasts for a very long time, and as I said, sometimes more than 100 years. So we should respect, you know, intellectual property of others, because we are librarians and we are in academics. And to the extent possible, we should promote the open access of publishing, and we should try to publish with Creative Commons licenses to promote the cause. So with this, I would like to thank the organizer once again for the opportunity given. And I'm really very grateful to the institution for making me understand about a lot of things involved in copyright issues. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Akhtar sir, for an extremely informative session on copyright. We really appreciate the way you made this complex topic easier for us. I'm sure all participants will agree with me that now we all have a better understanding of copyright issues. This has made us all aware and given us a direction in making our course content for online education in the right and legal way. Thank you, sir. And now we already have started receiving questions for Akhtar sir. Those who have not yet posted their questions, please do that in the chat group. Me and Dr. Meghna will pose the questions on your behalf to sir. Okay, so now we move to the question and answers round. So, we have received a question from Sumantra Chakrabarti. We are submitting papers for online publications. How far such submissions are protected, and what are the ways to cope with it?
No, it depends. You know, under which license you are putting your article. So, is it, you know, in the open access? So, even if it is open access, your rights are protected. But, you know, of course, people can make fair use of from your article. So I think there should not be much concern about that issue, that your copyright is not protected when you submit articles online.
Thank you, sir.
So the next question is, for a Google Classroom, if we incorporate the video or the virtual lab links, which are not under the Creative Commons license, do we have to take permission from the content of the publisher of who has made the content?
Again, you know, as I said, the person will have to check what the license says, number one. Okay. So if, say, for example, it falls under the use category just by giving attribution, then that is perfectly fine. You can give attribution. But at the same time, you know, you should not make a large amount of that particular work in your videos. As I said, to the extent possible, make less content in the online classroom, because, you know, physical classroom is completely different from online classroom. And having said that, please see the checklist. That checklist is very important. So if you see the checklist, and I'm very sure you, and the five things which I said, one was you'll have to check whether the material is copyrighted, and then number two, does it come under copyright? Does it have under public domain? Does it have any licensing issues? Is your use fair use? So all those questions you can ask yourself, and then I am very sure you perhaps will get an answer. Because, you know, it depends from video to video, from content to content. The content may be having different licensing. Every content may be having a different licensing. So you may be having the Times of India archive, okay, which is a database which actually provides you all the news right from the inception of the Times of India in 1936 or 33. But can you use that those images of Times of India in your research work? Of course you can use, but can you make it in a brochure, which may not be for a non-commercial purpose? Correct. So I think that whether it is for commercial purpose, whether it is for education purpose, so all those things really matter while using the content. So that is why I say, you know, this understanding of fair use is very, very important. Then perhaps we'll be able to answer a lot of our questions.
Okay. The next question seems to be from a librarian, Vijayananda Pradhan. He's asking whether e-books which are procured by any library should be taken into charge or accessioned just like any other printed books.
Yeah, this is a good question, actually. You know, what you should do is that you should ask for mark records from the publishers, number one, so that you don't have to actually enter data again in your database, Koha, or whatever you're using. So just import those things in Koha, okay? And if you have perpetual access, you see, the access should be perpetual. It should not, perpetual means forever, indefinite time, unlimited number of years. If that is the case, then there is no problem in, you know, importing those MARC records in your database and even accessioning it. There is no problem.
Thank you, sir.
Meghna, you are muted, actually.
The next question is use of scanned figures from a published book in an online classroom, does it amount to infringement of copyright?
I don't think, because as long as you are using within a closed group of students, okay, and you are not giving the rights of download, etc., the right click is disabled, and to the extent possible, it should be streamed. What I'm saying, people should not be able to download, and instead of using high resolution image, use low resolution image, so that others are not able to reproduce it. Because, you know, Again and again, I'm saying the same thing. You have to have a clear understanding of fair use. That understanding of fair use is very, very important.
At the same time, it is important to give the source of the figure as well, sir.
That is
a common practice. Yeah.
Yes, that you have to do it. That you have to do it. Yeah.
Okay, so there is one another question, sir. How do I copyright my content in India?
Okay, you see, as I said, you actually you have the one option, that is just put the material under with C within circle. That is sufficient. But if you want more security, you can get it registered with the copyright board.
So there is one more question which says, who holds the copyright of the course content, whether the faculty who has created or the institution to which the faculty belongs?
You see, I think course content should be the intellect property of the employer, that means the institution, unless there is an agreement between the faculty and the institution stating otherwise.
Sir, we'll take a last question.
Yes.
If content is prepared in the Google Classroom using online resources, some direct and some curated for a particular class of Institute A, can the content be shared to students from Institute B?
You should avoid.
Okay.
You should avoid.
Okay.
Sir, there is one question from author submits a research article or any of his work in the institutional repository, then who will have the copyright, the author or the institution?
You know, whenever we write any article, we should negotiate with the publisher, because, this is very flexible. So you should always tell the publisher that I will write for you, provided you allow me to keep a copy in the institutional repository, number one. Number two, if publisher does not allow the faculty to put his or her material in the institutional repository, then the previous copy, that is called preprint. Okay, so that preprint can always be put under the institutional repository. That preprint may not be the same as the final copy, but almost it'll be the same, but not exactly the same as the final copy. So I think that these two options can be explored.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So there was one question, about whether, how do we digitize library things and put it for NBLI? Okay.
Yeah.
So, first thing is that you actually don't need to digitize for NDLI. Okay, that digitization process has to be a very careful process. First, you will have to see the infrastructure. If you have the digitization, if you can undertake the digitization process. Number two, when you are digitizing, you make sure that you are digitizing those things which are copyright free. Okay, or the lifetime of the author plus 60 years have expired. And then if that is the case, you can give it to NDLI. But otherwise also, NDLI does not say that you give me a full text. So even the bibliographic information can be given and a link can be given to your university. So that I think we should be very clear about, digitization process. And as I said, though the amendment of copyright, which took place in 2012, you can digitize the whole library. Okay, it permits you only for storing. Okay, and maybe under fair use, you can make it accessible within the four walls of your library. So that, because that will come under fair use, in my opinion.
Okay, sir, another question is.
Yeah.
whether librarians can upload educational YouTube videos of their college faculty members on their library website under resources of institutional repository.
Take a declaration from them that these have been prepared in compliance with the copyright. Take a declaration and then do it. Because it's not happened that tomorrow you get into trouble. Get a written declaration from them. Like we take written declaration from our research scholar when they produce PhD. And you know, it also reminds me of a student's copyright. So students also have copyright on their work. So if there is a student who has written a wonderful assignment, so can you just use that assignment in the classroom? You can, provided you know you take permission from the student. So I think you should respect his or her copyright also, as you respect your own copyright.
Thank you, sir.
This is the last question that we will take. There are many questions, in fact, but due to paucity of time, where do we put the copyright mark on the document? How do we ensure that our document is copyright protected?
You know, one is that if it is a book, everybody knows where to put.
Yes.
If it is a video, maybe you can put it in the beginning that this is a copyrighted material and the copyright holder is so and so. If it is an audio, you know, on that particular licensing which you upload on YouTube, that information will be there, of course. If it is a journal article, of course, the publisher will have copyright policies. Okay, so I think it depends from medium to medium.
Okay. But
Madam, there is no set place for putting that C. It is up to you wherever you want to put, but it should be there.
Thank you very much, sir, for answering the questions and clearing the doubts.
Welcome, madam. My privilege.
Thank you for the wonderful session. Yeah.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.